Hello everyone, and welcome to Dungeon Delvers. My name's Karen Blent, and today I'll be talking about Dungeons & Dragons' newest announced book, Mythic Odysseys of Theros. This book is due to release on June 2nd, and is the second Magic the Gathering crossover. Now, for those of you who know me, know that I love Magic the Gathering, so needless to say, I'm pretty hyped about this next book. But for many people who've never played the game, most likely don't know anything about Theros. Well, that's what I'm here for. I'm going to be breaking down how things in Theros work, compared to the regular books that we are used to seeing. So, for starters, what is Theros? Well, much like Ravnica from Guildmaster's Guide to Ravnica, it is its own plane of existence. This means that the original stories of humans, elves, dwarves, and the other races are completely different, and their behavior is altered a bit. Additionally, and perhaps most importantly, the gods are different. While in games like Descent into Avernus, we have the sun god Pelor and the ruler of Hell Asmodeus, but on Theros, the sun god is Heliod and the ruler of the underworld is Erebos. And the reason I say this is the most important thing is because Theros is based off of Greek mythology. So this means that instead of the gods being these perfect beings that know all and see all, we get gods that have fears, hopes, and are faulty. They make mistakes and can become jealous and use their powers to attack mortals. Additionally, some of the monsters you'll find here are those classic monsters like Minotaurs, Chimeras, Hydras, and Sea Leviathans. There are all kinds of stories that are grouped with Theros, all having those classic Greek mythology feelings like the Iliad and the Odyssey. Now that we have the basics of what Theros is out of the way, and what you'll find here, let's get into what the book will include. First, we get two new races, the Satyr and the Leonin. Satyrs are those classic goat people that have a pan flute nearby. The Leonin are lion people that are incredibly prideful, pun intended. Both of these races are incredibly prominent in Magic the Gathering, so it makes sense that they would be added to this book to be playable races. Then we get to supernatural gifts. Not much is touched on this mechanically, but these could be anything from an ability score improvement, special traits depending on the god that gives you this gift, or what have you. According to the preview page, it is a set of special traits that mark your character for greatness. What this character option means is that instead of a normal background like knight, scholar, or noble, you choose or roll for one of these special gifts. This gives you a power-up, such as having the mind of a sphinx and being immune to mind reading, or you are an oracle, seeing the future and getting omens and prophecies from the gods. And since I keep bringing up gods so much, one of the most important features of the gods is that we are getting weapons of the gods. Now, we are getting something that will be incredibly interesting and fun for players. These weapons belong to the gods themselves, or at the very least were forged by them. What these weapons do isn't clear just yet, but belonging to a god has to mean something. In the stories of Magic the Gathering, these weapons are incredibly powerful, like Thassa's Bident and Godsend. Thassa's Bident can control great leviathans and move the ocean as the wielder sees fit. With Godsend, you can kill the gods themselves. Yeah, no big deal. And finally, we get two new subclasses, the Bard's College of Eloquence and the Paladin's Oath of Heroism. With bards, they are already masters of words. This subclass just makes it even more powerful, allowing their words to get through creatures that don't speak the same language. They also have the power to force people to believe what they are saying, even if what they are saying doesn't really make sense. With the Oath of Heroism, paladins begin to follow a path towards greatness, and they get power-ups that are the stuff of legend. Their near presence inspires those around them, as well as getting power-ups for a short amount of time that improves their combat prowess. Both of these subclasses fit in the Theros theme extremely well and can fit in other campaign settings. My only grief is that the paladin subclass essentially makes them the chosen one for story purposes, meaning they will most likely have the campaign revolve around them and their great destiny and what their god has planned for them. So, Dungeon Masters, make sure you don't focus on just the paladin and their otherworldly destiny. But what do you guys think of the new subclasses? Or even the new races? What do you think these god weapons will do? Why don't you let me know by tweeting me at @ctvgoofingoff and make sure you use that all-important hashtag, Dungeon Delvers. And until next time, I'll see you guys later.